I think you can see that Ann doesn't so much as lecture as engage us in a discussion. And I think it's one you'll take with you, those of you who are fleeing to the hall.
Did I go over time?
And if I'll ask Ann if she would honor us for a few minutes to take some questions from the microphones on the floor, and then I'll, after that, leave you to ponder the profundity that she's challenged us with. Please.
Wonderful talk.
Thank you.
But I'm quite stricken by the fact that this very last comment you made, which is that there's two ways of looking at it. And if you look throughout the history of human thought, it's very clear that humans have been set by the nature of our biology, set up to perceive duality in a very easy way. I mean,
to perceive
duality. Perceive the duality of things. You think of two opposites. I mean, the way we evolve, we have two hemispheres, two arms, etc. And my comment is that if you go all the way back to the ancient Chinese and the yin and the yang, and in the end, what they were envisioning was a universe run by two forces that were highly complementary, that apparently were contrasting and diverse, but ultimately for optimal functioning, it required the integration of both of them to maintain what the balance is. I mean, in a way, when you bring this comment forth, what you're almost asking, and I think it's the wisest fashion to proceed, is to hold both sides in mind.
Yes.
And, you know, not necessarily go off on, as I understand, you know, go off on one or the other.
And not think you can get from one to the other.
Yeah. And I thank you for bringing that forth. Thank you.
Yes.
That was a very eloquent lecture. I'd like to go back for a second to your example of the Rosetto community, where the people from the Italian-American community from Pennsylvania would live longer until the 70s, when something happened and they start losing that longevity.
Mm-hmm.
So to that point, I would like to entertain with you, if I may, an alternative or complementary explanation, which in this setting I think is appropriate. And that is the explanation of a potential cohort effect. Cohort effect.
Right.
So the people that in the 1970 were living longer were people that were born between 1890 and 1910. So these were people that most likely were born in Italy. They elected to live because they were maybe more brave or more desperate. They arrived here. They stayed here. They elected not to go back, otherwise you would have not seen in your cohort. They went then faced a pandemic in 1915, and that was a huge evolutionary pressure, and so on and so forth.
Are you familiar with the history of Rosetto itself, then?
No,
because they actually immigrated
with the history
in the early 19th century.
Of Italian immigration.
Right.
So I don't want to argue, you know, whether it's natural or nurture that Italians, you know, do not live longer. So the people that were born in 1920 did not have that effect. So my question is, did the cohort effect play a role? And if I may, on a more general note, I personally believe that this field would greatly benefit from more self-criticism. You know, in your lecture, there were a lot of good evidence, but there was a lot of positive evidence, and I didn't hear any negative evidence. I don't know whether this is because that evidence does not exist and is not published because of a negative publication bias, or you just elected not to share that.
Well, let me clarify that, because that's an important point. So thank you. I could have stopped at every one of these studies and presented the kinds of methodological and other kinds of criticisms that have been put to them, and virtually all of them have been. And I did say that the research is controversial, and I didn't want to make that. That wasn't the point of my talk. The point of my talk was trying to understand, in a sense, how we have emerged in a field where there is such interest and apparently such high stakes around the very question whether or not there is a spirituality health link. But to take the case of Rosetto, for example, there have been some that have suggested that actually Stuart Wolf completely misunderstood what was actually the factor involved in the Rosetto's heart healthiness and the Rosettans' heart healthiness. And instead, they've said it had to do with the fact they drank a lot of red wine. because they're and people have been critical of the church attendance data because they've suggested that it's simply correlation. There's a correlation between church attendance and longevity and general health, more greater degrees of health. But that could simply mean that people who are already healthier are able to get out of the house more and go to church more often. And there's no cause, but the church attendance is not itself the cause of the greater healthiness. So these kinds of things could have been said, but then I would have sort of ended up giving a different kind of talk. But I don't want there to be any misunderstanding. This is a very fraught field. And in some ways, it's such a fraught field that the fact that there's nevertheless such popular and broad-based excitement about it becomes all the more interesting. A lot of the excitement is built in some sense on relatively thin reeds. And therefore, from a point of view of an historian who's interested in the cultural making of scientific phenomena, it becomes even more interesting to me. I hope that's helpful.
Thank you. If we could do this with a brief question.
And a brief answer.
We'll take the last one.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, and I'll try to be brief. With your statement, which I think is correct, that there's a tremendous amount of interest in this personally as well in that spirituality helps, like your one slide, and yet having been trained as a scientist, I believe in the phrase that extraordinary claims require extraordinary proof.
Right.
So with all of this interest, there are lots, in my opinion, of charlatans in this field as well. And the question is, what are your thoughts on this, and how do you monitor out the charlatans so that they don't mislead people?
Well, that's in a sense, I don't want to be glib about it, but that's kind of that's a collective job, and in a sense, it's a job for public relations, for how the medical profession learns better to engage with the public. Here's a question back. Why, if the medical profession is as skeptical as so many of you are about so much of this data, why haven't you been more successful in quelling the appeal and the apparent persuasiveness of the charlatans, as you call them? What is it about the way in which you talk or about what you maybe don't understand about your public that makes you less effective communicators? So I think an answer would be to better understand your public. And this comes back to the question about the need to be social scientists and not just medical scientists. That because the public is not just a set of people who don't understand or are ignorant and need to be educated. They are a group of people with active needs and agendas and concerns that need to be engaged. So that would be it, perhaps, an answer.
Thank you. Let us celebrate this.